we'll ease into the program.
All right, good. Well, that's fine. Sounds good to me.
Yeah, you look nice. Nice color on you. Hey, everybody.
Thank you.
You look great. You
know, Jay, things are going so well for Mary and I. I just, you know, I almost hate to say so, because you know, you wait for the other shoe to drop. But we have been we've been doing so well, feeling so good, enjoying our lives so much. It's almost not fair that we're happy.
I think you look great. I want to just in case somebody finds this video that isn't familiar with you, I just want to formally introduce you and welcome everyone to Chef AJ Live. This is the show where I introduce you to amazing people like you who are doing great things in the world that I think you should know about. Backed by popular demand is Dr. John McDougall. Last week, he gave part one of a brand new lecture on my favorite food, the potato. And today he's back to give the second part of the lecture and maybe even answer a few of your questions. And we have a surprise guest coming on. So please welcome back Dr. John McDougall. People are always so happy when you come on, Dr. McDougall. They just love you.
Well, that's probably because they see I have such a good time. You know, I enjoy this so much, AJ. And, you know, I found your gathering of people is a real home for me. I mean, you've told people this is what you have to offer. There's no nonsense. You're not going to compromise. You're there to help them. They feel unconditionally loved, you know, and so I feel very comfortable coming on your site and sharing with people. And actually, you know, what I've been doing lately is I've been using this group as a test group for new lectures that I put together. It used to be that I'd go to advanced study weekends or occasionally in the program, I'd launch a new slideshow. And of course, I have to do it once or twice or three times before I want to put it on permanent reel. And last time, which was last week, we did a nice show on the first part of the potato lecture, which I'm going to go over really quickly. And, you know, I asked people for some help, and it was amazing how many helpful comments I got, AJ. And I added some things in, like, you know, people want to know about potato peels, they want to know about acrylamide, et cetera. Many of them I had already in the lecture, but some of the things I was able to add new because I could see that that's what people wanted. So I invite you again to help me. This lecture that we're going to give part two of, and I'm going to do a quick review of part one. This lecture will go up on our website permanently, and we'll be sending it out to people after I get it packaged the way I really want it. So Dr. McDougall at drmcdougall.com, please give us an email. And let's see what else. We don't start another program, another 12-day program until January. So you got plenty of time to sign up. Boy, you don't, do you? Christmas is right around the corner. It's scary. I know time goes so fast.
Well, I think after the holidays, people might need to sign up, if you know what I mean.
You know, it's interesting, AJ. You always used to think that our residential programs would fill most in January, where people, you know, want some redemption from all their debauchery. You know, we would expect that in January, people would want to, you know, make New Year's resolutions and get some help and get going. But actually, January is usually a very slow program for us. I talked to Heather yesterday. We're almost full for the January program, so we will fill it. But I have to tell you, it takes until February or March before people get out of their holiday mood and are willing to get things straightened out, I think. Otherwise, I don't know why January is usually such a light year. And it has been for the last 34 years when we've been running at residential programs.
That's really interesting. I guess maybe because they feel they can do it on their own, and then they realize that at a certain point that they need.
I think they still have the taste of chocolate cream pie on their lips. They don't want to give it up. I don't know. I really don't know. I would think that a new year, especially one which passes on 2020, which has been a very difficult year. You know, people would celebrate by getting themselves in order. And certainly I encourage you to do it. I've been encouraging you to do it, you know, because of not only your chronic problems, like diabetes and heart disease and obesity and constipation and indigestion and multiple sclerosis and rheumatoid arthritis. I mean, your chronic problems, which we can get rid of easily. If you have any doubt, I offer you a 4-month challenge. You will be cured of these problems in almost every case. Because you've dealt with the cause. The cause is the food. You know, I wish I could be sexier. I wish I could be more complicated. I wish I could appear like a well-educated scientist and make a very complex theory for you, but it's not. It's just the darn food. And once you get the food fixed, as far as the quality of the food, not the quantity, then you solve these problems. Why? Very simple. These are caused by food. They're dietary problems. Just like I saw an ad on CNN News just now for a psoriatic medication, and they have these medicines that stamp down the immune system. Yeah, well, why is the immune system so excited? Why is it attacking the skin and the joints and the eyes and the heart and the blood vessels and so on as it does in psoriatic arthritis? Why is the body attacking itself? Well, it's the food. It's reacting against foreign proteins like dairy protein and so on. So why would you not expect a cure? You should expect a cure. You know, this is the 21st century. We are scientists. If we look back at history, the cure is right there. Anyway, I'll challenge you. Give me 4 months. Won't cost you a thing. Give me 4 months. We'll get rid of your rheumatoid arthritis. Your MS will stop having attacks, et cetera. Yeah, your bowels will be great. Anyway, how did I get carried away on that subject, AJ? I got to get back to what I came here for, which is a talk on, let's see if we get this going. I want to review quickly the first part of the lecture I gave last Saturday, very quickly. And maybe AJ has that up someplace so that you can watch the whole.
It's on YouTube right now. They can still watch it in its entirety.
They can watch it in slow motion. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's see what we got here. And all right. So the potato, I want to talk to you about the potato. The potato is my favorite food, no question about it. And if I had one food, just so you know, you said to me, John, and it may come to this with COVID-19 and everything and the economic depression. If you said to me, John, I'm going to give you one food, that's it, one food and water. Or you get to live amongst the germ and dirt, so you get bacteria, B12. Get plenty of B12 if you live a filthy life. I'll do that, no problem. But I get one food. And that's potatoes and water. That's what I'm going to choose because it has all the vitamins, all the minerals, all the protein, really clean food. And you'll find out how productive the potato is. I mean, the potato likely will save the world. I think so. And in addition to the right kind of food, you have to have clean air, clean water. You have to have surroundings that are comfortable. You know, I mean, some of you live in some pretty toxic surroundings. Get them fixed. Get rid of that bad husband. Get rid of those toxic children. Get rid of that bad job. You know, try and make your surroundings comfortable, and you need companionship. And of course, most of you know my favorite companion, that's Mary. Little activity, walk around a bit. That's about it. And potatoes. I've been known as the potato guy. In fact, this issue of Veg World focused on me and the potato. Yeah, if I was going to be known as something in history, I'd like to be known as Dr. Potato, as opposed to Dr. Lard and Dr. Pork Chop and Dr. Stinky Cheese and whatever else you want to call some of these other folks. Call me Dr. Potato. And I started writing about potatoes in 2002. This was one of my first newsletters in 2002. The potatoes are the pillars of worldwide nutrition. Unbelievable. And I've had battles with anti-potato people over the years, like, for example, Robert Atkins. We met at the Great Nutrition Debate in Washington, D.C. in the year 2000, and we debated as to whether a low-carb diet was best as opposed to a high-carb diet. And I was very contesting when it comes to Robert Atkins. I was as nice as I could be. I mean, I didn't do what I wanted to do. You see, what I wanted to do, and I asked Mary if I could do this, is I said, Mary, you know, this is in prep for the debate. This is a debate in front of 500 cameras, at least worldwide. I said, Mary, during the debate, Robert Atkins is going to stand up and say, my diet, the Atkins diet, is so effective and so easy to do. And I said, when he says that, I'm going to say, okay, fatso, stand up and take off your coat and show us how effective it is. Mary said, I couldn't do that. Well, you know, that's one of my regrets in life. I should have done that in front of 500 cameras because the guy was at least 60 pounds overweight. It was obvious. Fat, sick guy. Anyway, if I had to stand up for one side of the high-carb movement as opposed to the low-carb movement, I would pick the potato as my food to fight this battle. Yes, I'm going to battle on a potato. Second to last book that Mary and I wrote was The Starch Solution. Notice we put a potato on the front. If you use your imagination, you can see that potato makes a certain hand gesture. Did you notice that, AJ?
Yep. That's funny.
There's a hand gesture there in that potato. I'm not going to tell you what it is, but there is there, and it kind of says what I want to say to a few people. Anyway, maybe you'll have to put a little sub note and tell people what that means. But the starch, can you believe that I made starch and a potato the theme of a book that I'd spent my life putting together? People thought it would be suicide. Well, I thought it was important that you understood the concept of starch. And starch is an important word. Industry has tried to get us to forget that word so we can't identify the food. So they've called what we now call, what we used to call starch, they now call complex carbohydrate. You have no idea what a complex carbohydrate is. Industry has stole the nomenclature, the words, and you don't stand a chance. Lots of books on potatoes. I've read every one of these books. I would encourage you to look through them for history and science about the potato. Potatoes should be the worldwide pillar of nutrition because they have the greatest chance of supplying the most food, doing the least damage to planet Earth. I mean, they're grown in 130 nations. You can grow them at almost any elevation, almost any moisture content. There are, you know, maybe 600 different species of potatoes. Potatoes are an important, affordable food in our diets, and they have been for thousands of years. The potato originated in South America in the Andes. We had potatoes, of course, in North America at about the same time. And then about the 1600s, it spread to Europe, changed Europe, drastically changed Europe. We have evidence of potatoes being in the Americas, in North America, in the area of the Four Corners. They call the Four Corners potatoes. It is at the corners where the states join Utah, Colorado, Arizona, and New Mexico. They have a Four Corners potato, which is like 10, 12,000 years old. They've been growing as supplying the energy needs of these Native Americans. It's been around for a long time. You probably remember most about the potato, the tragedy that happened in the mid-1800s, and that was the potato famine. The Irish became very dependent upon potatoes. Actually, all of Europe did. When the potato was introduced into Europe, malnutrition and starvation ended. War stopped. I mean, it changed the entire continent around. In Europe, the population doubled in a matter of 50 years in England and Wales. The Irish doubled their population to 8 million between 1780 and 1841. Well, anyway, this nasty microbe came along and created something called the potato blight, destroyed half the potato crop in 1845, and over the next 7 years, it destroyed three quarters of the crop and left people in a very difficult situation, which caused them to immigrate to other parts of the world. And 2 million people immigrated primarily to North America. There are a couple of side notes here, and one person brought out the side note for me, which I think is important. I won't dwell on it, but it's not that I didn't notice it. And that was, it wasn't just the loss of potatoes for the Irish that caused the mass starvation. It was the efforts of its neighboring countries to withhold other sources of calories. They withheld the wheat and the barley and the corn and any other food source that the Irish might have as a political gesture to basically exterminate the Irish, you know? So if it had just been for the potato blight and there had been the support of countries around Ireland at that time, we would not have had the potato famine. We wouldn't have had the mass migration. And I probably wouldn't be sitting here right now because I'm Irish and my ancestors came across at that particular time. All right, World War II, they knew the importance of potatoes. They told our soldiers, hey, you gotta fight. Well, potatoes, great source of energy, good cheap food to win World War II. Well, the potato became of prominence to the World Health Organization in 2008, which they declared the International Year of the Potato, because people realized with the WHO, the World Health Organization, that we're in big trouble. And the potato has the biggest opportunity to allow us to continue to inhabit planet Earth and survive as a species. 2008, the International Year of the Potato. As far as nutrition goes, potato is very complete nutrition. What I encourage you to do, and of course, a potato is a very high starch, high carbohydrate food, but we could generalize the discussion that follows over the next minute or so to all kinds of starches. What I teach is a starch-based diet. This means that when you look at your plate by eyeball, 70 to 90% of your food on your plate should be starch, rice, corn, potatoes, beans, peas, lentils, breads, pastas, etc. You don't have to measure it. Don't weigh it. Just look at it. And you make this switch from the American diet, which is very low starch, to a high starch diet with fruits and vegetables, and water is your beverage. And of course, this fits in with traditional diet of people. I really want you to keep this in mind, that the way we eat now is an aberration. People have only eaten this way in mass for the last 50 years. Prior to that, if you were going to eat the rich Western diet, you had to be a king or queen or aristocrat. The other 99% of the population who worked in the fields lived on rice or corn or potatoes. And then we had the Industrial Revolution. We had the harnessing of fossil fuels. And pretty soon everybody became rich worldwide. And they, of course, adopted the rich Western diet. So as a result, people look like kings and queens of old. They're fat. 80% of the population is overweight in developed countries. They're sick. They have gout, diabetes, just like the kings and queens of old. And the traditional people who did all the hard work, who built our capital, who built the pyramids, the traditional people ate a diet of rice, corn, potatoes, etc., with very little meat, probably no dairy. All right. Okay. Potatoes are very complete nutrition. And one kind of dramatic demonstration of how complete a potato is when it comes to nutrition is they took 11 Peruvian children who were starving. These kids were suffering from malnutrition. And what they fed them was potatoes to regain their health. And they did. All their protein came from potatoes. Almost all their calories came from potatoes. Potatoes are sufficient alone. You can live on potatoes even as a baby. Of course, these children should be having breast milk, but obviously the circumstances didn't allow that. A man and a woman in 1928, both of them were athletes. They were triathlon and marathon runners. They were housed in a metabolic ward by this particular scientist, who was the scientist that coined the word vitamin. That's how famous his laboratory was. And what they did is they asked this man and woman who were athletes to eat nothing but potatoes for 6 months. And they agreed to do it. And they had them under lock and key so they knew exactly what they ate. And they evaluated their condition 6 months later. And a couple of important statements come out of this paper. And by the way, you can get this paper on the internet. Yeah, you can read the whole entire paper, and I encourage you to do it. Just look up all potato diet and you'll find it. They did not tire of the uniform potato diet, and there were no cravings for change. I agree. I could live on potatoes and water alone, throw in a little barbecue sauce, and I think I'm in heaven. And even though they were both physically active, they were described as in good health on a diet in which the nitrogen was practically solely derived from potatoes. The nitrogen being the protein. And I'm putting an entire lecture on protein for you folks, which maybe we'll give next weekend or the weekend after. People have lived in modern times on all potato diets. For example, Charles Voigt. He is the Washington State Potato Commissioner, and he went on an all-potato diet, ate nothing but potatoes, 20 potatoes a day for 60 days, lost 21 pounds. He's kept the weight off for 8 years. He was actually a guest speaker at one of our advanced study weekends. Has a great story to tell. And then we have our down under, we have the SpudFit guy, Andrew Taylor, made a splash on the history of nutrition about 3 years ago when he lost over 100 pounds. Cured his depression and all kinds of other physical and mental and emotional problems by simply going on an all-potato diet. And he runs actually an organization called SpudFit, which you may want to get involved in, which focuses on an all-potato diet. Actually, it focuses on a starch-based diet like we use. And what did Matt Damon take and grow on Mars when he was stuck there for a year? Not pork chops. No, grew potatoes. All right. We also have a all-potato diet if you want to go that route. And it is a diet. It's not our program. And that diet would be Mary's mini diet. If you want to, you'd live on all potatoes. Potatoes and a few vegetables. That's it. Make it simple. Many of you are having still problems. You're not losing all the weight you want to lose. You don't feel as good as you should feel. You have other issues that are, you're almost there, but not quite. And what's the step for you to take? Well, you don't eat out anymore. I know that because that was changed by COVID-19. eat simple. You know, find two or three things you like and eat them over and over again. Mary and I have oatmeal for breakfast every morning. Last night, what did we have last night for dinner? Yeah, anyway, we eat a few different dishes for dinner every night. Simple. The diet I teach is a starch-based diet. Starch is made by plants. Only plants make sugar, which is converted into long chains of sugar called amylose and amylopectin. Only plants make sugar. No animal can do it, no fish, etc. And it, what happens, the plant takes carbon dioxide from the air, water from the ground, and with the energy of sunlight through the process of photosynthesis, it makes glucose, which powers the activity of the plant during its growing cycle. But it also provides an important part of plant's life by allowing it to germinate, to sprout, to become anew in the spring after it's died. This source of stored energy, this starch, amylose, amylopectin, is stored in plant parts like the roots and the seeds. Stored in plant parts to make available energy for when the plant has to become anew, when it sprouts again in the spring. That's why the starch is there. But of course, we take advantage of that starch. Now, I classify starches into two groups. One, above ground storage organs, which are seeds, which are, by defining it more, they're grains and legumes. In other words, wheat, corn, beans, peas, and lentils, etc. Those are above ground storage organs. They're unique in the sense that they provide everything you need except for adequate amounts of vitamin A and C, which you're going to add by adding some extra fruit and vegetable. Now, below ground storage organs, hey, below, above ground, not very hard to understand, right? Below ground storage organs storing energy for that time when the potato is going to sprout anew. We have various root organs, like potatoes and sweet potatoes and cassava and bulbs and corms and et cetera. Those are below ground storage organs. What you need to know is that the below ground storage organs have all the vitamin A and C that you need. You've seen this demonstration before. If you haven't, I'd like to spend about a half an hour talking to you about it, but I won't because I can't. But three practical reasons why you want to eat a starch-based diet to be trim and healthy are the fact that a starch-based diet is calorie dilute. You see the stomachs on the right-hand side of your screen, your corn, your rice, your potatoes. You see how big a volume that 500 calories makes. Each of these stomachs has 500 calories. So corn and rice and potatoes are calorie dilute. I couldn't even find room for all the potatoes to make 500 calories to fit in my stomach. And the calorie dense foods are butter, olive oil, salad dressing, cheese, etc. Meat. Those are calorie dense. So they don't fill up the stomach. You don't get full. The second principle is the fat you eat is the fat you wear. The body does most efficiently. Everything you eat, the body is not going to make mistakes. It's going to be efficient at utilizing all of the nutrients. And so what the body does is it takes the fat that you eat and stores it away as the metabolic dollar for the time when no food is available. That's why it stores the fat on your buttocks, thigh, and abdomens, because it's looking forward to a famine. The fat you eat is the fat you wear. The body stores it effortlessly. So how much fat are in these foods? Well, butter, 100% fat, olive oil, 100% fat, salad dressing, maybe 99% fat, cheese, 70% fat, meat, 60 to 80% fat, rice, 5% fat, corn, 9% fat, potatoes are 1% fat. There's no fat to wear. Well, those of you who need to lose some of the excess fat need to know that. And then the third principle I tried to teach you before I left you last time as a final discussion in the first lecture is the idea that it's starch, it's carbohydrate, it's sugar that satisfies your hunger drive. And if you don't eat sugar, you're always hungry and you're out of control. You think you're an obsessive compulsive overeater. You have an eating disorder. It's because you haven't given the body what it needs for satisfaction. And of course, all these three things fit together. Calorie dense foods are high in fat that you will wear and lack carbohydrate to shut off your hunger drive. Whereas the foods I teach you, starches, vegetables, and fruits, are calorie dilute. There's almost no fat to wear, but plenty of fat to take care of your metabolic needs. And it's loaded with carbohydrate to shut off the hunger drive. Most of your fruits and vegetables are 75 to 85% carbohydrate. There are certain cells in the body that only run on sugar. That should tell you that these low-carb diets are wrong as far as nature's concerned. If you don't have sugar, then the body will cease to exist. No, it doesn't do that. What it does is make sugar. If you don't eat sugar, the body makes sugar. It takes protein from your muscles or maybe from the food you eat. And through a process called gluconeogenesis, it converts protein into sugar. Because sugar is required to get the red blood cells to function, to get the retina of the eye to function. There's certain kidney cells that don't function without sugar, and the brain prefers to live on sugar. That shows you that we are a sugar eater. All right. Any questions on the first part, AJ?
No. Well, there's questions that came in advance, so why don't you finish the talk, and then we'll do that.
All right. Okay. So here we go on to part two, which is all new, which you're welcome to comment on part one, except that I had to rush through it. But let's take our time and go through part two. This is the first time I've done this presentation. Hopefully it doesn't sound like it, but I put a lot of work on it. You'll see that. And I want to give you part two on the potato. Potato is a staple. I mean, you identify society as a potato eaters, just like the Asians are identified as rice eaters. And the people in Central America are identified as corn eaters. Potatoes are a staple food. Think of the Irish. Nutritionally complete. As a matter of fact, potatoes are an anti-scurvy food. In other words, scurvy caused by lack of vitamin C, which is a horrible disease, which killed lots of people, particularly those people who went out to sea and brought with them grains and legumes, which have no vitamin C or vitamin A, or not enough of it. Remember, I told you that. I told you above ground storage organs are deficient in vitamin A and C. Well, when the fruits and vegetables rotted, which they do in a matter of a few days, you were just left with the grains and legumes. So you became vitamin C deficient. You developed scurvy as the sailors went out to sea to discover new lands. And the British solved this, didn't they? And the British to this day are known as the Limeys. Why? Because they discovered that if it took limes long, they would last. And you didn't get any scurvy at all. Well, they could have taken potatoes too. Potatoes are also an anti-scurvy food. And potatoes have all your vitamins and minerals and everything you need, except for B12, which we can get into as a separate subject. I hear from people that they shouldn't eat potatoes because potatoes are white food. Don't eat white food. Well, you know, what people are reflecting on is the fact that white sugar is white and white flour is white. And white rice is white. Yeah, but cauliflower is white. And potatoes are white. Stop for a minute and think about your high school science class. And what you learned was that in your nutritional part, you learned that colored vegetables are more healthful. So you're looking for colored vegetables. Most of the most color you're looking for. Well, what is white in terms of number of colors and in terms of intensity of colors? White is all colors. What is black? It's the absence of color. So if you want to talk about the most colorful vegetables there are, they're white potatoes. And by the way, here are two articles that you might want to read on the fact that we need to focus again back on white foods and that we're missing an awful lot of good nutrition because we have developed some biases that are incorrect, telling us that we shouldn't eat potatoes and cauliflower and turnips and onions and parsnips and mushrooms and corn. And they're highly nutritious foods. White food is good. It's not white rice. As far as performance goes, athletes have focused on potatoes as a fuel. And potatoes have been declared a savory race fuel option because winning athletes, your marathon winners, your triathlon winners, they live on high starch diets. And it could be potatoes, could be corn, could be breads, could be pastas. But this particular article focuses on potato puree as being a convenient and very tasty way of giving that high energy to athletes who need to perform as far as strength and endurance is concerned. I took care of an athlete, Mary and I did, for several years. And this is a man that I met on a show called Twin Cities Live in Minneapolis. And we were sitting in the green room waiting to go on. And Carl Lewis says to me, hey, I don't remember the exact words, but he says, hey, look, I can't lose weight. I'm a few ounces overweight. I can't lose weight. Every time I try, I can't perform. What could I do? Well, I said, Carl, why don't you take a look at this book? It was probably the McDougall program, 12 Days to Dynamic Health, that I was out selling. See, I spent my life selling books. And I said to Carl, I said, hey, read this. And you know, all of his entourage, they thought that was a pretty interesting idea. And so Carl Lewis started our program. This is probably 1991, 1992, started our program and got the Santa Monica track team to follow our program. And while on our program, as discussed in this Runner's World issue, Carl Lewis set the world record for the 100-meter dash on the McDougall diet. Set the three best records for long jumps and won at least three gold medals. And he was an old man. He was 36 years old when he finished his career. Anyway, Carl Lewis did well, to say the least, on the McDougall diet. Potatoes are fattening. People stay away from potatoes because they're fattening. And you know why they're fattening. It's because of the stuff that you put on potatoes. On potatoes with bacon and cheese, you more than double the number of calories. You increase the fat, the saturated fat, the cholesterol. You decrease the amount of fiber. You know, everything. Everything has changed in a negative way by putting the toppings on. And I didn't have to give you that answer about potatoes being unhealthy. You already knew that potatoes were only unhealthy because of the toppings we put on them. Actually, potatoes are an anti-Western disease prescription. Now, people come to me sometimes just overwhelmed. They've got cancer, heart disease, terrible diabetes, et cetera. They don't know what to do. They don't have the support they need. They come to me and say, what am I going to do, Dr. McDougall? Well, how about just living on potatoes and water, or sweet potatoes and water, if you get this figured out? Because they're complete nutrition, you'll do just fine. Yeah, you'll lose a lot of weight, but you probably need to lose a lot of weight. So you don't have to think about this a lot. The food was designed complete by nature long before it hit the dinner table. Anyway, with a all potato diet, we have gotten tremendous results, or at least we could have if we fed them all potatoes. We get the same darn results we get on the regular McDougall program. We found that people drop their cholesterols, they get off their blood pressure pills. 90% of the time, people are able to reduce or stop their blood pressure diabetic medications. Great food, to say the least. It's been suggested in a special way that potatoes may be extra beneficial as far as neutralizing stomach acid, relieving joint pains, itching. Potatoes have been used as a large part of the Gerson therapy, which is an anti-cancer program that has been taught for almost 100 years. And I've looked at the Gerson therapy and the Gerson protocol, and I can tell you it's no worse than what you'll get from standard chemotherapy and standard oncologists. Anyway, I knew Charlotte Gerson. I don't know whether she's still alive or not. And Max Gerson, I didn't have a chance to meet, but I've read his work. All right. The importance here, and if you want to succeed with the program that Mary and I and the group teach, you need to start thinking of yourself differently. I know you've thought about yourself as an omnivore. Some of you have even go so far as to think of yourself as a carnivore. You're not an omnivore. An omnivore eats a little bit of everything. Meat, you know, a dog's an omnivore. A cat's a carnivore. People are herbivores. But what we get fooled by is the fact that the human body has a tremendous ability to survive. We put up with, half a bottle of whiskey, two packs of cigarettes, and hot dogs wrapped in bacon, and we live. So by eating a mixed diet and still staying alive, not dropping dead immediately, which would be an appropriate reward for eating the wrong food, what happens is the body survives. And we get fooled into thinking, oh, everything must be okay. I ate a piece of steak, didn't have chest pain. Don't see the heart surgeons outside my door. Well, you know, I realize there's not an immediately motivating stimulus in most cases from eating the rich Western diet to get you to change. It's kind of the same way with other bad habits. If you took one drink and you ended up falling down, you know, so brutally that you broke half your bones, you wouldn't drink, would you? If you smoked a couple of cigarettes and you ended up on a respirator, a mechanical respirator, you wouldn't smoke, would you? But no, we can tolerate these things with and fool ourselves into thinking everything's okay. Because the death is a slow death. The point I'm trying to make here is you should start thinking of yourself as a starch eater, a starchitarian, a starchivore. You're not an omnivore. You are a survivor. But if you want to look, feel, and function your best, you need to live on starch. Early on in my life, I really knew there was something wrong, and that was the foods that I got at the dinner table. I have to say the liver and onions were probably the worst thing that I ever had at the dinner table, which, of course, my mother believed was one of the most important and nutritious foods for me to eat. It wasn't. It wasn't just the liver I couldn't eat. I couldn't chew. I couldn't chew the beef on my plate. I would chew and chew and chew, and I'd get this big glob in my back of my throat. I didn't know what to do with it often. Thank goodness I had Bonnie, my boxer, who would sit at my table side. And when my parents look away, I took the globs of meat that I'd hit under the edge of the plate and I stuffed them in Bonnie's mouth. That's her food. My mother should have been saying to me, hey, Johnny, you've got to eat the liver to get all the iron that you need. And you got to eat the meat for your protein, drink the milk for your calcium. What my mother should have said is, of course you can't eat the meat. You have the wrong set of teeth. Give it to Bonnie. We are set up from head to toe as starch eaters. Let's take a look at our main seeking device when it comes to food, and that is the mouth along with the nose. The nose, of course, smells and the mouth tastes. And it's the combination of the two that gives you the perception as to whether something's delicious or not. The addition of the smell to the basic tastes. The basic tastes, as you probably know, are sugar, salt. Those are the pleasurable tastes. Sugar and salt, they're on the tip of the tongue. But there are also two other tastes that help protect us from poisons in the environment. This is bitter and sour. When we eat poisonous substances, the body naturally spits them out because of these taste buds, the sour and the bitter taste buds. Now, there have been a couple other taste buds that have been discovered. One is umami, which is something that's described as a taste for MSG. And people will say, well, that proves we're a meat eater because we have this. It does not. It proves you have a taste for MSG. And then there was a taste bud recently discovered for fat. But it's interesting about the fat-tasting taste bud is that it is a taste bud designed for repulsion. If you can taste fat, you are repelled by it. It's not an attractive, but a detractive type of relationship. You don't eat it. So those who have the taste bud for fat are usually trim. If you don't have the taste bud for fat and it just passes by your tongue without even being noticed, guess where that fat ends up? And then most recently at Oregon State University, OSU, scientists discovered a taste bud on the tip of the tongue for starch. What they did is they took chemicals that block the sweet-tasting taste buds. You know, the body of the tongue would get confused with if you left the sweet-tasting taste buds unblocked. They blocked them with a chemical substance so that they would not function. And then they fed the people various starches like rice, bread, potatoes, corn, and they found that there was an attraction as strong as for sweet to these starchy substances. We're starch eaters, ladies and gentlemen. We're also survivors. And this, of course, was found in scientific studies. For example, Susan Holt did some basic work where she took subjects, she fed them various kinds of foods and asked them how satisfied they were. If you'd like to look at the original research, you'll find that potatoes are 7 times as satisfying as croissants and twice as satisfying as meat and cheese. That's what the scientific research says when they ask people, how do you feel after you eat? How do people end up eating meat and dairy? because at best they're bland. At worst, they taste terrible. Think of it for a minute. Would you sit down to a plate of raw beef or chicken? Or, okay, I'll let you cook it. What about boiled beef or boiled chicken? It really doesn't heighten my interest, I'll tell you that. How do I make that interesting? How do I get it down? Well, to get over these bland and often disgusting tastes, what we do is we add lots of salt, lots of sugar. We make combinations of salt, sugar, and spice in the form of ketchup, steak sauce, barbecue sauce, sweet and sour sauce, and we dump that all over the food. And then we can eat it. I mean, I often feel like saying to people, if you really like it, prove it to me. Go ahead, eat that chicken. Okay, I'll take the feathers off. Okay, eat that chicken. All right, I'll cook it for you. Okay, eat that chicken. You don't like boiled chicken? Well, then I'll cover up the taste for you so you can get it down with steak sauce. Some of the concerns that people have about potatoes I'd like to address now. There are all kinds of subjects that don't have a lot of interrelationship, except they are things that have been brought to my attention as concerns about potatoes. One question that came up from the last lecture was, well, I've heard that I should eat raw potatoes. I should eat the skins of my potatoes, whether I cook them or eat them raw. I should eat the skins because that's where all the nutrients are. Not true. You know, the nutrient content of the skins is barely more significant than the nutrient content of the white pulp. There's no reason to eat the skins. If you like the skins, fine. You know, when we make mashed potatoes these days, we put them in a slow cooker, or let's see, Instant Pot. I guess the Instant Pot is the way we go. And my job is to take the potato masher and mash them up. Well, I'll tell you, I don't take the peels off. But I don't think it would be of any negative consequence for me to do so and to throw the potatoes in the garbage, the potato skins in the garbage. Yeah. Solanine poisoning. Another thing people say as an argument that you shouldn't be eating potatoes is they are toxic. They'll make you sick. They'll give you stomach aches, weakness, depression, and stomach distress, diarrhea, vomiting, et cetera, if you eat potatoes that are spoiled. How do you tell a spoiled potato? Well, they have buds on, and if you look under the skin, you'll see a green discoloration. So what's the answer? Don't eat rotten food. Don't eat fresh potatoes. Keep them properly stored so that they don't end up producing the solanine under the skin, secondary to rotting. On nightshades, people tell me that they don't want to eat potatoes because they fit into a class of various plants that have solanine, which is that toxic substance, so to speak, which only becomes an issue if you eat rotten food. And so there's a whole theory out there. It was actually the fellow's, I believe his name was Childers, back in the 1930s. He taught people that they would cure their inflammatory arthritis and even osteoarthritis by staying away from nightshades. Well, you know, I've looked for the research that supports that. I've looked for the patients that support that by having them come in and say to me, Doc, I gave up the nightshades and all my arthritis went away. I've never seen that. And I've been at this for 50 years. Now, there are some people who are sensitive to potatoes and eggplant and other individual foods. Fine, stay away from them. But as far as staying away from a whole class of foods labeled as nightshades, you shouldn't do it. It's not going to give you the results you're looking for. The results you're looking for are going to be had by eating a starch-based diet with strict adherence to avoiding animal proteins, because they are the initiator in these inflammatory arthritis. Animal protein, dairy protein, pork protein, beef protein, etc. Another concern that's come up recently about potatoes is a substance that's produced called acrylamide by heating carbohydrate, by heating sugar. And this substance in the laboratory has been shown to be cancer promoting, acrylamide. And it's been one of those things where people will say, okay, nothing safe to eat. I might as well eat my pork chops. I mean, I can't eat my potatoes because they have a cancer-causing substance in them called acrylamide. Well, you know, maybe so. Maybe it's an issue. Let's see if we can avoid it. The way you avoid it is you just don't overcook your starches. The acrylamide doesn't start to form until you get above 248 degrees Fahrenheit, and that's way above boiling, or steaming. So, you know, just don't overcook your starches. And besides that, you need to know, and I followed up on the research in this, you need to know that epidemiologic information, in other words, when we look at populations of people and the rates of cancer and their eating of acrylamide and various foods, what we don't is we do not find an association of cancer with acrylamides in populations. This is something that's basically confined to the laboratory. You know, overheating of sugar with protein results through a Maillard reaction results in the formation of acrylamide. Fine. It's irrelevant. A glycemic index. People say don't eat potatoes because they are high on the glycemic index. Glycemic index is calculated based upon the rise in blood sugar that occurs after you eat a food, compared to a standard, which is white sugar or white bread. So what we'll do is we'll take subjects and we'll feed them various types of food. We'll see how high their blood sugar goes over the next, say, couple hours. And we'll assign them a value called a glycemic index when we look at the rise in blood sugar, and we compare that to how high the sugar would rise if you were to eat white bread or white rice. Well, first of all, I want to say the reason to eat is to raise your blood sugar. That's why you eat. You're looking for energy. People have gotten confused. They think elevated blood sugar means you're sick, means you have diabetes. Not so. There's an appropriate metabolic response to eating, which is your sugar goes up. It's supposed to. It has nothing to do with diabetes, which is due to an incapacity of insulin to function, either because it's not present or it's paralyzed. It has nothing to do with diabetes. And besides that, if you compare various foods, like chocolate cake has a very low glycemic index of 38, compared to a baked potato, which is, 85? Or, you know, rice has a glycemic index, let's say, of over 100, and a Snickers bar has a glycemic index of 67. Now, how are you going to say that a Snickers bar is better for you than a potato, or a chocolate cake is better for you than a baked potato? Makes no sense at all. You see, glycemic index is just one characteristic of food. There are so many other qualities of food that determine whether it's healthy or not healthy. You know, it's the vitamins and minerals and phytates and processing, all kinds of things, what's added and not taken away and so on. So you should expect the potato will raise your blood sugar. It has nothing to do with diabetes. You should not be lulled into the idea that low glycemic foods necessarily mean they're healthy foods. They're not. And I offer you chocolate cake and Snickers bars as an excellent example. Question comes up. How about sweet potatoes versus yams? Well, you know, we eat sweet potatoes. We call them yams, but we eat sweet potatoes. Maybe you can talk to Mary about that when she comes over to Met. Yes, the reason we eat sweet potatoes is because they're so much more colorful, more moist, better tasting. And, you know, that's pretty much all you find in the store. You can find...
yams.
Sweet potatoes.
No, those are yams. The ones you're talking about.
I'll let you come over later to straighten this out. But the sweet potatoes are purple.
The ones we had last night were yams.
Were they?
Yeah.
I know. We're going to have to talk about this. Okay. My understanding is that yams are more dry, more rough, more scaly, brown color. All right. Well, we're going to have a little argument about this. Like I say, I don't care what it says on the package, Mary. All right. If we take a look at various yams, various nutritional makeup of potatoes versus yams versus sweet potatoes, you find out nutritionally they're basically the same. They're high fiber, high carbohydrate, no cholesterol, low fat foods. All right. Let's talk about some sweet potato eating populations. Traditionally, Papua New Guinea has been a sweet potato eating population. As a matter of fact, there was a time before the 1980s when 92% of the food came from sweet potato roots and leaves for the people who lived in the highlands of New Zealand. Now, these are warriors. These are people who are athletic. These are people who have children. They have big families. They, you know, work hard in the fields, etc. And they live on a diet that's 92% sweet potatoes. And that would mean they live on a diet that has adequate energy, is 90, almost 95% carbohydrate, 95% sugar. And the result is excellent health. People have a low cholesterol. For example, research data from people who live in Papua New Guinea, who live on a primarily sweet potato diet. Again, that was something they did before the 1980s. They had low cholesterols, no diabetes, no heart disease, strong, hearty, healthy people, no diabetes, et cetera. Potatoes really, to me, as I started off this whole discussion, really play a part in our future, our immediate future, I believe, because the world is in such turmoil. And I think potatoes have an important place at getting us out of the mess that we're getting in and will continue to get in. And historically, we've noted that whenever potatoes flourished in a population, the population was satisfied. Peasantry were placated, they say, by adding potatoes. As I mentioned, we brought peace to the continent of Europe in the 16, 1700s. With the introduction of the potato, war stopped, and so on. The potato, to me, is the food that we really ought to focus on to save planet Earth, because it is so easy to produce. It is so complete. Yeah, I think potatoes are going to be the food that helps planet Earth get over the climate warming that we're having right now. In fact, I think if we focus on simplicity and don't make it real complicated for people, and maybe we start a slogan, you know, 10 potatoes a day cuts global warming gases by 10% in your life. I don't know, some kind of slogan we got to get. I'm sure you guys will help me figure it out. Where we tell people, we get kind of little slogans going on how to save the planet. Well, you know, I'm going to pick potato as my warrior. The other thing that's concerning a lot of people today, and you know, this is particularly relevant with the COVID-19 pandemic that we have going on. You know, Mary and I, of course, I suppose because we're retired and we spend a lifetime getting ourselves stable in a stable situation. But we hear that out there in the general public, things are really tough. You know, people can't pay bills. You know, people are going to have their homes foreclosed on. They got to figure out any way they can keep their families fed, they can keep their costs down. Well, if we taught people the truth, you know, just think of the folks suffering in the United States and Europe. If we told them the truth about food, they can make a huge impact on their, you know, basic economic condition as far as their family's concerned. I'll never forget the day that Mary and I went into Costco, which used to be my biggest entertainment for the week, was going to Costco. Don't ask me why, but it was. We went into Costco one day and we're standing in line, and in front of us was an overweight Hispanic man and woman with three little boys. And they looked typical, you know, typical American, overweight, sickly, et cetera. And they had a whole basket full of food. And I watched the food go down the line. And pretty soon the woman, the homemaker, she just to the cashier, "Stop! I've only got $300. I can't buy the rest of the food." You know, Mary knew what I was thinking and she held me back, because what I wanted to do is I wanted to say, "Lady, gentlemen, kids, come on back here. I want to show you how much it really costs to not only cut your food bill, but to get your family in great shape. You know, so dad can be more competitive in the work market. So mom can take better care of us or be more competitive in the work market. You got to be in the best shape you can to get a job these days." So I take him back into one of the aisles in Costco. I can tell you where our aisle used to be, the bean and rice and potato aisle. And I would point out, I'd say, "Look, you can buy 50 pounds of white rice for $35. You could buy 25 pounds of brown rice for $19. You could buy a 10-pound bag of potatoes for $8. And look at you're buying all these expensive meats, dairy products, and so on. They're making your family fat and sick. Yeah, well, you know, like I say, Mary held me back. But I have this great temptation to tell everybody in the world that not only do they have a chance of saving the planet, saving themselves, curing their diseases, but changing their whole economic status by not buying foods that are poisonous and expensive. Oh, they're all tied together, as this whole lecture has been hopefully somewhat tied together for you. My interests in medicine started out by dealing with chronic diseases. That's all I really cared about, chronic disease. When I was a young doctor training back in the 1980s, I wanted to be able to help people with diabetes and high blood pressure and overweight, and indigestion and constipation, etc. I wanted to help these people, and I have. You know, for the last 44 years, that's all I've done, is taking care of chronic illness problems. With great success, we published this in the scientific literature. You can expect to get well if you're suffering from a dietary disease. For the last 16 years, 17 years, all I've been focused on is the climate. Why? Because my first grandson was born 17 years ago. I have 7 grandchildren. I have focused my attention since the birth of my grandchildren on what's most important, and that is helping them have a future. I never want to be in a situation where my grandchildren say to their mom and dad, why didn't grandpa try harder? Why didn't grandpa try harder? Well, they're not going to say that because I'm going to try as hard as I can. To deal with the climate, of course, eating potatoes is going to save the world. And as we've talked about on many occasions, and I'll repeat for you very quickly, whether or not you go on to the more severe complications of COVID depend upon what kind of health you have previously been in. If you were in poor health, like the typical American, heart disease, diabetes, et cetera, you have 12 times the risk of hospitalization and 6 times the risk of dying. Anthony Fauci says if you don't have these comorbid conditions, you don't end up on a respirator, a mechanical ventilator. You don't end up in the hospital. You don't end up dying. That's what Anthony Fauci, the famous infectious disease specialist, told us when he testified in front of Congress in June of this year. So now we have an angle to interest people in a starch-based diet based upon saving themselves from COVID-19 and the next epidemic and pandemics that come through. It's all diet, folks. It's all diet. Well, people ask what we're going to do, or ask us to offer some suggestions in terms of what you could do with potato dishes. And all I could figure out is what I know how to cook, which is a baked potato and a carton of Dr. McDougall's Right Foods soup. And you might consider this the basic method of eating for you too. You can live on potatoes and Dr. McDougall's soup if you want. But Mary, you have some ideas. Why don't you come on over here? Tell people what that is. Well, you got to even get your chair though.
Oh, I was just going to bring over one of these and be a little higher than you.
Put your chair. All right. So any questions as we get organized here with the A team?
Yeah. Well, first of all, this isn't a question, but I'd just like to read this comment that Andrea sent in, and she said, I often think about a wonderful article Dr. McDougall wrote many years ago entitled The Annual Physical Exam, A Ritual to be Avoided. It greatly influenced my thinking about doctors, lab tests, prescription medicine, lifestyle, and a healthy plant-based diet. A few years ago, the office manager of my designated primary care physician, who I visited maybe 3 times in 10 years, called to scold me for once again failing to schedule my annual physical and some routine lab tests. I continued to resist in frustration. I blurted out, I guess you're not calling to congratulate me on my good health. Shortly thereafter, they fired me as a patient. Dr. McDougall, thank you for the lessons learned.
So what would you call this, Mary?
The yam.
We
call it a sweet potato because it's easier, but a sweet potato is kind of yellowish white, and it's the inside is sort of yellowish white and sort of dry.
Does anybody else want to weigh in on this?
I learned never to get involved in marital squabbles.
This is a serious marital dispute. We don't get into many of them, too.
Hey, Dr. McDougall, if you're done with the slide portion of the presentation, maybe stop screen share so we can see you a little bit bigger.
I will do that.
Yeah. I just think it just tastes delicious, whatever it is. I don't even worry about
it. Wouldn't you, what would you call this, a sweet potato?
Oh, I'm not going to say anything.
Come on, he knows better.
No, I do know better.
What I read
is sweet potatoes are more moist, more colorful.
Yams.
No sweet potatoes. All right. And so nobody wants to weigh in on this.
We don't want to touch that. I know that the white, you know, it's funny because.
It's a sweet potato. It's a sweet potato.
But if you cut it or break it.
Yeah.
That's what I was going to do.
Okay.
I just call it lunch.
Yeah.
All right.
But these we use a lot too.
Yeah, well, those are regular old potatoes.
No, they're not. Some of them are red potatoes. There's purple ones in here.
You wouldn't call any of these sweet potatoes.
No.
Okay. These are potatoes.
These are potatoes.
That's a sweet potato. And we don't have any yams. Okay. Well, if nobody's going to take Mary's side.
Well, I think they're just afraid.
Well, we got to get this right before I put the lecture out permanently. So we're going to spend all morning, you know, arguing about what. We'll look on it.
So, Dr. McDougall,
we had sweet potatoes last night for dinner, which Mary called yams.
These are yams.
When you were talking about.
Yes, me. All right. Well, we'll figure this out. We'll get it straight.
Wouldn't you call those? I mean,
I would call
them.
They
call them sweet potatoes, but they really are. If you look in the store, they're called garnet yams.
Yeah, but they're mislabeled, Mary.
I need to mislabel.
They're mislabeled.
I'm going to show you a picture of a sweet potato.
All right.
We could take a poll on that.
No. I think somebody should weigh in, really, quite honestly.
Maybe a botanist.
Because actually, what I heard was that yams are not true potatoes. They're different.
Well, they're monocots as opposed to dicots. How about that?
I don't know what that means.
Well, I'll tell you about that later.
Well, a lot of people in the chat are saying Mary is right, just so you know.
So darn it.
And they're saying, and some people are saying it's a garnet yam. So, a couple of people said Mary is wrong. What can I tell you?
All right, let's see.
He's looking it up on Wikipedia right now.
Oh, good.
Wikipedia is a good
description. I know they're technically botanically different.
They are.
But sometimes at the store, I think even like a lot of times the white ones, which I call Hannah yams that I love. It's some, like, for example, at Whole Foods, they're called Hannah yams. It's
sprouts. Look at this.
White sweet potatoes.
Look at this. Although the soft orange sweet potato is often called a yam, the sweet potato is very distinct from the biotechnical yam, which has, anyway. So
it's called a yam in many parts.
Yeah, but they were wrong.
They're not wrong.
All right. We'll look it up. We got to get this straight before we get the final lecture.
Next time we go to the store, I'll show you.
But Mary, I'm trying to tell you, they're mislabeled in the store.
They're mislabeled in the store?
No, yes.
They have bins in the store of white potatoes and sweet potatoes that also look almost like white potatoes.
All right. Well, this obviously is not going to be settled, and you guys are not going to help.
Well. I think we need to like go to a store like Gelson's where they really know their produce. Oh, somebody typed a big thing in the chat about the distinction between them. So if the store mislabels them, what can we do?
I think probably they're called both.
Yeah.
But, you know, I remember when we had our program at the Flamingo, I would call for sweet potatoes in a dish that I wanted them to make, and they would end up being the white sweet potatoes, and I didn't like those as well as the yellow or the red sweet potatoes, which I never call yams. I always call sweet potatoes.
Well, we'll obviously get this settled.
That's why he feels that way, is because I always call them sweet potatoes.
It's not a feeling, Mary. This is science.
You guys should have a show. You guys are adorable. So yeah, Dr. McDougall, I always think it's a good idea to put a potato on any book a person.
Yeah, there you go. I like that. Yeah.
Well, absolutely.
I would have to ask if that's a sweet potato or a potato that's a potato.
But you know, AJ, you and I are very similar in the sense that we feel like we can slap them in the face and telling people they need to eat potatoes. That's about the biggest slap in the face you can get for somebody that's trying to regain their health, because they think potatoes are the worst food in the world. Potato is one of the more maligned foods in the world. You know, people talk so negative about it that this is a good place to start. Start at what people think to be most correct, which is most wrong.
Well, you know, you mentioned in your talk when you were talking about the glycemic index, and I think in the case of somebody that's already diabetic, what happens is when they start eating potatoes, initially their blood sugar does go up, so they panic and they feel, well, see, I can't eat potatoes or rice. You know what I mean?
This is with everybody who has diabetes. They're all very much focused on their blood sugar. And this is why it's nice to have them under direct supervision like we did in the clinic and we do now through the telemedicine program. I mean, every day somebody's checking on you. Is that when you initially change to this kind of eating, you may be eating a lot more, you know, high carbohydrate foods. You may be eating a lot more calories. You might like the food more. And as a result, your blood sugar will go up. But the long-term thing that you need to know is that as you continue to eat this way, it only takes 3 or 4 days, the insulin becomes much more sensitive. In other words, functions at a much stronger level. And the blood sugar generally comes down. And with the added weight loss, it always comes down. And all cases of type 2 diabetes are cured by changing to the diet I recommend and associated weight loss, all cases. You know, and I can say that, AJ, because, you know, the standard medicine teaches that you can cure type 2 diabetes at a rate of about 80% just by doing bariatric surgery, by rearranging somebody's gut. 80% of the type 2 diabetics are cured with the weight loss that occurs, you know, from gut surgery, from intestine surgery to cause people to lose weight. So if they can cure 80% of the people with their surgery, I can cure 100% with a good diet.
Yep.
And they're still eating the garbage. You know, they put them through these surgeries. What do they tell them? Eat everything you want, you know.
Just in small amounts.
Well, they throw up. They don't have any choice. They're sick. You know, they make people sick is what they do. They rearrange their guts and make them sick.
Yeah. Well, like you say, the truth is simple and easy to understand. It's almost too simple. People want to overcomplicate it, you know, because somebody named Mary is saying, well, don't you think people should eat greens 6 times a day like Dr. Esselstyn recommends?
I think it's focusing your attention on the wrong area. You need to get the starch in. That's the most important thing. And then after that, you know, you can pay attention to the green and yellow vegetables if you want. And remember, you can live on potatoes and water alone. So, I mean, how can you make a sweet potato and water diet any better nutritionally? You know, I just don't see it. I don't see adding more phytates, more phytochemicals, more vitamins, more minerals, more green color, more whatever to the basic diet of sweet potatoes will do anything to encourage faster, better health.
No, it'd just be prettier because you'd have all the green around it.
And you'd eat less food because you wouldn't like it. What has happened here is that they've taken a little bit of truth and expanded it into misinformation. Yes, you need vitamins and minerals. Yes, there are phytochemicals that are anti-cancer, anti-infective, and so on. But it doesn't necessarily mean that taking more over the amount that you need is going to cause you greater benefit. It's like if you have a car. You know, this may be kind of hard for you to relate to. It is for me, but try and go along with the analogy. If you have a car that has 8 cylinders that requires 16 spark plugs, 2 spark plugs per cylinder, I think. It requires 16 spark plugs. Okay, once you put the 16 spark plugs in those 8 cylinders, what if you add 4 more spark plugs? How about 8 more? You know, Once you've provided enough vitamins and minerals and so on to make the machinery work properly, how in the world can providing more than the adequate amount to function in an excellent way. Why would providing more cause anything good? It doesn't make any sense, except for the idea, if it's good, more has got to be better.
Yeah.
You can get into big trouble with that philosophy.
Yeah, well, people are saying you're brilliant, Dr. McDougall, but they're saying, but what about microbiome diversity? We need a variety of plants.
No, you don't. A microbial diversity depends upon what you feed the gut bacteria. And if you feed them sweet potatoes, they're going to be as diverse as they can possibly get. Adding extra fruits and vegetables is not going to change their diversity in any more favorable way than a basic starch-centered diet. Again, you've already provided all the necessary ingredients for the machinery of the body to work. Throwing in some extra spark plugs ain't going to make a darn bit of difference.
Well, I agree with you, but people are saying, but I'm insulin resistant, I'm diabetic. You give the whole lecture and they
It's hard, especially since they don't understand, AJ, because they've been told so many different things. But what I want you to be faced with the fact is that everything you've been taught has guaranteed that you'll stay sick. As Nathan Pritikin used to say, the American Diabetic Association diet is a diet guaranteed to make sure all diabetics remain diabetic. So you've been so misinformed, I understand why you can't get over these barriers. And this, of course, is why we run the intensive programs. We used to be able to lock you up in our center in Santa Rosa for 34 years, we did that. In California, we'd lock you up and take care of you. Now we get to even do better. We get to come into your home via the internet. And we will get you through these tough times. We'll get you through the days when your blood sugar goes slightly up as your insulin is becoming more efficient. We'll go through those days with you. We'll help you adjust your insulin levels, your medication levels. Yeah. But you can't change the truth. The truth is that eating the American diet paralyzes insulin activity along with a whole bunch of other things and creates a condition where the blood sugar is up. That's also associated with a whole bunch of terrible diseases like cancer and heart disease and blindness and kidney failure and so on. The problem is the food. And one of the manifestations of the food is the sugar is up. Well, that's fine. You don't really care what your sugar level is, whether it's 100 or 250 or 350. You just want to be healthy. Anyway, that's probably further than you want to go on that subject.
Do you want to tell us when the next program is? And Dr. McDougall, I have somebody in the broadcast studio that is a recent graduate of one of your programs.
Oh, I'd like to hear from them. Next program is going to be in January. We've got a program. Yeah, I don't know what it is.
There was a young lady watching last week that had mentioned how great your program was and that she wanted to come on and give a testimonial.
But good. Well, let's.
Her name is Pam. I couldn't bring her on last week because I didn't have her address, but she is here now. Hi, Pam. Thank you so much for being here.
Yeah, hi.
Hi,
Pam.
There.
We recognize you. We saw you last week.
Yeah, absolutely.
How are you enjoying the follow-ups?
Oh, it's wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. You know, I have lots of things to say about the whole program. Should I continue?
Please.
Well, first of all, before we get to that, I just want to make a comment about potatoes. Before I began studying potatoes more with you, the only way I knew potatoes was French fries and baked potatoes with butter. And that's the only way I understood potatoes. But since then, I've learned all kinds of ways to prepare potatoes without that. And my taste buds have changed enough that a potato is just a snack, a plain, nothing on it potato, you know, just munching. You know, when I used to drive, you know, out of town, I'd have maybe a bag of potato chips. And now it's just, let me have a potato, munch, munch, munch. So just a thing, you know, it's, we can learn other ways to consume potatoes. But as far as the program, I was in the September class, and I want to tell you that I have known about your teaching since the 80s. I have one of your first books. I used to get the newsletter from you too. And I was a lacto vegetarian at that time, but I believed everything you said, right? But I still didn't follow it, okay? I used your information about health. You know, doctors didn't like me when I tell them I don't want to have a mammogram. I was a non-compliant patient. Still, I didn't put your suggestions into practice. Then I became a vegan. And vegan, no meat, no dairy, no eggs. But I learned from you that I was a junk food vegan. I thought of junk food as just only eating massive amount of potato chips, but I learned that it's also, oh, getting your vegan pizza, oh, getting your vegan crackers, oh, getting your vegan cookies and all that. So because I didn't follow you really, and I don't understand why, although Dr. Lyle, who's one of your people in the program, kind of explained something about motivation. You had advertised the program last summer, and I thought, oh, I know everything. I know how this works. I could give lectures on the McDougall program. Do I really want to spend this money? Do I have enough money? I really don't have enough money for this. And then I pondered it and pondered it and pondered it, and I realized this is about my health, and I need a kick in the butt. I may know this stuff, but I'm not able to put it into practice. Even though I know it and I believe it, I wasn't able to put it into practice. Your program has been life-changing and I cannot recommend it enough. I just want to tell people, don't hesitate, sign up. The space is limited. Dr. McDougall does not let his class grow to 100 people or 250 people. Which he could do, you know, it is by Zoom. You could have that many people in the class. I think it's limited to 30 or something like that, which means we have lots of personal attention. And we have these wonderful lectures by his team, Dr. Lyle, who talks about the psychology, Jeff Novick, who teaches about calorie density and how to cook foods, Dr. Lim, who got me off my blood pressure medication in 3 days, and we are still meeting. We just met with Dr. and Mary McDougall just a few days ago, our September group, and they are great. They were answer questions, and it's like you're in the room with them, and same with the other people. In addition to that, they have given us the email of every member of the team that we can contact at any time. And Dr. McDougall says that we are their patients for life if we need that. And I cannot tell you how much I am so, so grateful for that program and that they offered it by Zoom and they offered it at home, which even though I live close to Santa Rosa, it's just a short drive, I wouldn't have been able to afford the live-in program. So it's been wonderful. Thank you, Dr. McDougall and Mary.
Well, thank you. That's a wonderful testimony. It's nice. Most of the people who go through the program feel that way. I imagine all of them don't. But, it's a reflection of our staff, and our staff is very talented, but most importantly, they really love what they do. Can you imagine how good we must feel to come to work every day and to meet people who have challenges ahead of them, who we can answer their challenges and help them have a better life? Can you imagine how good that feels? Like, just for you to say how much you appreciate what we've done for you, I mean, it feels good. And so, we have a group of people that we've been with anywhere from 30 years to 5 years. I think 5 years is our youngest staff member. And the reason they stay with us and the reason they look forward to every day is because they have as much fun as you guys do. I've said once, and I should say it many times because I really mean it, is we enjoy this program so much that we should pay for you to come. And we would if we could, but we can't. So,
I just want to add, in case I didn't mention it earlier, that your support people, like Tiffany and Corey, that we met, we've been meeting with them every week since September, and they will help us with challenges that maybe we didn't understand that we had during the 12-day program, and it's been absolutely invaluable, and they've been so much fun, and it's great, the follow-up that you do. I mean, it's really, really wonderful. And I encourage people, sign up now before the spaces are taken. Honest to goodness.
Well, thank you. We want to be in a situation where we're able to help everybody. It's not fun. It's challenging, but it's not fun to have people not do well. You know, and so we're going to take every extra effort, whatever is necessary, even if I end up meeting with you extra time, which I end up doing with several of the participants. I'll spend extra hour, 2 or 3 or 4 hours with them during the program. to make sure they understand their problems and how to get over them. I've even, just in your program, I've even had the opportunity to talk to some of the participants' own doctors. I mean, the ones that haven't hung up on me. You know, I just,
and we also do a, I'm sure Pam remembers this, every morning at 8 o'clock, John and I have a like a fireside chat with everybody in the program that wants to come.
Yeah.
And so that's part of every morning during the program.
Yeah, no, yeah, it is so absolutely cool. I mean, I don't know if they got sick of me, but I always have one question after another, after another, uh-huh. after another. And it is so awesome to get it from Dr. McDougall's mouth and Mary's mouth right then and there, instead of hunting for the information in the books or online. And I don't know, it's worth more than all the money that I have. Absolutely.
Well, I'm glad you feel that way. We want you to participate with our programs, thinking it was the best money and time you ever spent, and maybe even the best vacation you ever had, even though we used to be able to say that when you came out to Santa Rosa, California, and mean it. You may not find being home, even though we're there with you, a vacation, but people seem to enjoy themselves, even if they have to work. And we have folks who, like, for example, those from Lumen, which used to be called CenturyLink. They're one of the companies that we take care of their employees. They even worked during the time when they went through the program. It wasn't ideal. We really didn't want that to happen, but they had obligations with their company that required them to put a certain amount of time still for their employment. And so there is extra time by being home that you can continue to take care of the kids and the spouse and the laundry and
little extras.
Yeah. And it's convenient in the sense that if you don't make a lecture, you can watch it that evening. We record all the lectures you can.
And you don't have to travel to get there.
You don't have to travel to get there. No.
And,
So it's a way of communicating that we never understood until we started doing it. Just like we had a nice meeting with all of our family at Thanksgiving. And I have to say that was the best Thanksgiving I've had that I can remember. I got more time to talk to more of my children and grandchildren than I've ever had before or ever did in person. Somehow the internet takes down barriers in communication that allowed me to ask him questions, to engage in conversations that we wouldn't have had if we'd been sitting side by side in the room. And we find that with the telemedicine program too, is there are communication opportunities there that we never realized. And they seem to be much better than a live-in program. And yes, cutting the cost of the program more than half of what it used to be helped too.
I just want to read a comment from Vegan Trucker Lady and thank her for her super chat. She says, Dr. McDougall is a hero and Mary is a saint. And Jerry, who's watching live, said, I learned about Dr. McDougall through Chef AJ and participated in the November program. It has been life-changing, even with an autoimmune disorder.
Okay.
Oh, great.
Autoimmune disorders are really fun to treat. These are people with ulcerative colitis, Crohn's disease, various kinds of arthritis like psoriatic and rheumatoid and lupus. Because these people, their future is hopeless. They're really in big trouble. People with rheumatoid arthritis, for example, within 20 years, half are dead with complications related to the disease. You know, they're in big trouble. And for them to be able to turn around their disease in a matter of 4 to 7 days, they start getting better in 4 to 7 days. And usually by 4 months, they're dramatically improved or cured. The sicker you are, the happier I am, because the better you're going. I'm a serious AJ. I know it may sound a little perverse, but I really get enjoyment out of helping people. And of course, one of the feedbacks are the positive things. I realize that the negative things, the problems people have, we need to deal with also, pleasant or unpleasant. But I love to help people, and those in need of most help end up with having most improvement, end up being some of the people I remember most. You know, the desperate patients with heart disease and cancer and diabetes and autoimmune problems.
Nice. Well, I'll put some links so people can register, and there's still a few spots left. So check it out because it's really great. I haven't participated as a patient, but I participated as an instructor. I got to do a cooking demo and they let me watch the live sessions and they were fantastic. And especially the morning session, it is like a fireside chat with Dr. McDougall and Mary. They're in their home, you're in your home, you can be in your jammies and comfortable, and you can cook the food along with us. And it's just been wonderful having the program online.
And you're going to do it again, right?
I hope so. I would love to. Are you kidding? It was so much fun.
You know, AJ, you're part of the family.
Yeah. I just interviewed your daughter last week on the show, and I found out things about her that I didn't know, that she had been a little rebel at one point.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, but see, that was okay, because when our kids were in high school, rather than getting into heroin, and minor thievery, they went to McDonald's to rebel. Yeah, you know, it was a big deal for Heather to have her first double cheeseburger McDonald's. Wow. You know, that's how she rebelled.
Wow. Well, I guess that's better than heroin, right?
Better than heroin.
But for some people, you think it was heroin because they can't seem to break the addiction from
junk food. And if you look at the overall damage destruction done to our society and to the planet, and to people's lives and their families, the food is more destructive than heroin. It's more destructive than heroin, with the addition of cocaine, with the addition of alcoholism, with the addition of tobacco use. I mean, these things are far more destructive, or far less destructive than our present agricultural society, the animal stock, livestock breeding, and consumption that occurs is far more damaging to everything, individuals, families, communities, earth, everything.
Valerie watching live says, I couldn't afford your live-in program, but your live program saved my life. It reversed my chronic stage 4 kidney disease. And
I'm glad to hear it. Well, we've always tried to make the program affordable, AJ. And of course, some of the limitations we had is getting people out, which was expensive. And then we had to fix the food for them for 12 days, and that was costly. And rent a beautiful resort was costly. And so, as I say, the charge for the program is far less than half. It's probably a third of what it was if you take into account the transportation, the other inconveniences and expenses. Probably costs about a third as much as it used to.
Yeah.
In other words, you were spending, you want to hear what the numbers are, you were spending $6,000-$10,000 to come out and see us in Santa Rosa. Now you'll spend, what is it, $2,500?
Yeah, something like that.
Something like, I don't even know what the price is.
Well, I think the nice thing is because even if people did really well at the program, they still have to go home.
Yeah.
And learn to recreate it. Yeah. Now, and so they can do the things they need to do in their home while they're learning about what foods they can say, hey, is this okay? And they can show that, you know, they can, it's very interactive.
Yeah, they do that too, yeah.
And if they have a problem, say their blood sugar goes too low or too high during the day, you know, they can always talk to one of us, particularly Dr. Lim, he's always there. And so they have ongoing care for those 12 days. And we didn't touch enough on the afterwards. You know, it was just you've been enjoying weekly meetings with Tiffany and Corey, and monthly meetings with Heather and Mary and I. But we plan on not only the routine aftercare that we have scheduled in for a year, but Heather has also added ongoing aftercare. So if you want somebody to come into your home from the McDougall team every week, we'll do that for the next 10 years. You know, it's just an added service. And there are many people that, you know, get involved in the program where cost is not an issue. You know, they just want to be well. You know, they spent, you know, $150,000 on a car. You know, and here they're on the verge of dying. Their health becomes the most important thing. And so we've made available as many things as we have so far. We're always looking for new ideas. The addition of the ongoing medical follow-up care was our latest idea that came out since we started the programs.
Yeah, it was suggested by one of the participants.
Well, in fact, I think it was a woman in your class, Beth, is that, you know, she's a very wealthy lady, I assume, in the Sonoma County. And for her, it's it's not an issue. She just wants to stay well, get well. And for, and she's pretty much signed up for us, for with us for life.
Well, it's nice. So, I mean, you know, I mean, it was horrible having to leave Santa Rosa in the pandemic, but you know, the bright spot is now more people can access your programs than ever before.
And AJ, we have so much more time. You know, we don't have the time of traveling and the other things that take time. So it's easier for the staff to focus our attention on what's really important for the participants. Yeah, what things that used to be inconvenient are not inconvenient thanks to the internet.
Joanne says, can I ask about the coaching nutrition certification that you offer?
Right. We have a START certificate, which you get a certificate, okay, that which says that you are trained in the START solution, which means you've taken a test that I prepared to deal with the course that I prepared that teaches you about the START solution. And you take this course, you take the test, you get a START certification, which you can hang up in your office or, you know, put on your stationery, whatever you want to do, that says that you know, you know, whether you practice it or not is another thing, but at least you know the START solution because we tested you on it. Anyway, it's a class, and I would say the certification in many people's mind is something of extreme value, and they use it a lot.
And they use it, yeah.
Yeah, and they've gotten a lot of business from having that certification. Esther, so anyway, you get this. Pardon?
Esther, who you know, because you endorsed her book. She said, I took the course, and it was great. I'd love to take that test and just see if I could pass.
Yeah, well, you probably could, AJ. It's not that hard.
As long as you don't say, what's the difference between a yam and a sweet potato?
There you go. Just don't ask that question. We should do it. You know, there's got to be somebody out there with more knowledge on this than we have.
Probably. Yeah.
Well, I am going to find him and have him on the show. It has been so fun. I mean, I could just stay here all day and talk to you. I'm free till 2, but I know that people probably have to eat lunch and all that kind of stuff. Pam, thank you so much for sharing your testimony. I really appreciate you coming on.
And if you guys have any questions about potatoes or any suggestions about the potato lecture, besides figuring out whether yams or sweet potatoes, Mary and I are going to work on that today.
All right.
Well, and please write me at drmcdougall@drmcdougall.com so I can add that. Or corrected for the permanent lecture on potatoes.
Right. And don't forget to, if you miss part one, it's available on YouTube, and I'll send you a download of this, Dr. McDougall, if you want to look at it. And thanks so much for being here, Dr. McDougall and Mary. We love spending time with you. And if you like spending time with them, sign up for the program because you get them every morning. It's like the first thing when you wake up. Can you imagine how successful you'll be if the first face you see is Dr. McDougall in the morning? Make it pretty hard to go off plan, let me tell you. And thanks to all of you for watching another episode of Chef AJ Live. Please come back tomorrow when my guest is a plant-based ophthalmologist who I'll be meeting for the first time, Dr. Joyce Cho. Take care, everybody. Bye, Dr. McDougall and Mary.
Bye-bye. Thanks.
Bye.
Thanks for the opportunity, AJ.